Today we're talking about the art of reinvention and how it is a necessary art form with the wonderful Neil Cowley.
Thanks. Thank you.
Neil's already been on the juice, so it's going to be quite interesting. Yeah,
I found out this is alcoholic, Copperberg. You just told me it's alcoholic.
He was like, is that alcolic?
And I'm like, slightly
yes.
Blurry.
No, it wasn't Ribena.
I thought it was. I thought it was a kid's drink. Sorry. Just reinvented myself through a pint of lager.
You don't have any kids here, do you? So you're not acting out any of those. How are you doing?
I'm good. Yeah, I'm very good. Generally or here today?
Both.
Here today, I'm completely surprised by this. I didn't really have any idea how it would manifest itself. But it's incredibly vibrant, very active. And this venue, I've never even been to this venue. This is beautiful in itself.
It's awesome. There's loads of different places. This one's one of the brighter ones, so we can see everyone, which is nice. So I wanted to start by basically going back to the beginning of your journey. So we had a nice long brunch, and we spoke all about this. And I know that you've been through many, many different forms as an artist, both as a session player, but in your own band as well. Mm-hmm. And now you're doing your own thing. And so that is kind of what we're to talk about today.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Where did things all begin for you?
Well, I was a sort of archetypal child prodigy kind of area of the world, in the sense that I had an aptitude to play the piano. My father left an upright piano in the house, and him and my mum used to have parties. And so it was left there. When my dad vacated, the piano was left. So I used to just sort of plonk around on it. And so my mother sent me to a classic story, really. My mother sent me to a piano teacher called Mrs. Rickson, who had an ever-expanding nose. And she used to give me marks out of 10 every week. And I got this sort of record amount of marks out of 10. So it was clear I had an aptitude.
At what age is this?
Well, 6 or 7.
Okay.
Yeah. But so they drilled me. My whole childhood was spent with them drilling me a classical music education, which I had no hand in, really. I just sort of looked around me and saw what was going on, and I was... I was sort of chosen to play little concerts and things like that. And then in my school, there was a lack of teachers that actually played the piano. So when it came to singing hymns, they called on me to come up. So there was this little kid playing hymns like Kumbaya. And,
oh, we've got a kid. Come on, Neil.
Exactly.
Jump
my
up.
First ever gig, yeah. The borough advisor for music saw this, heard about this, and came and saw me. And he approached my mum and he said... Well, I tell you what, I think the kid's got something. I'll teach him myself for nothing, which was a lovely gesture. And he taught me for 2 years. He was a huge man called Eric Stevenson, a huge 6'6" man who used to frighten the life out of me. And he taught me classically. He taught me Shostakovich, he taught me Bach, he taught me Mozart. But none of this was my choice. At no point did I think, this is what I want to do. I wanted to be a zookeeper, or I wanted to be a paleontologist, or... an ologist.
I can imagine you as like a paleontologist.
Right, yeah, with the glasses and everything. Yeah. So I wanted to do something historical. It was only when my mother worked with this guy called Martin at this freight company in Southall, and this guy Martin said to my mum, "We're starting a Blues Brothers soul band, and we need a keyboard player." And all these guys were in their mid 20s, and I was 13. And my mum said, "Well, my boy plays." So,
your mum was like really like pimping you out there.
Well,
piano pimping.
Well, what amazes me in retrospect is that she was allowing me to go out until 2 o'clock in the morning. You know, she was a right on mum, really.
She's a cool mum.
Cool mum. And so I was introduced to this cacophony, this noise, two bass players. There was a drummer who was actually a paraplegic. It was an amazing collection of people. The guy couldn't use his legs. But he used to blow. He couldn't make the bass drum work without blowing into this blowpipe, which went into a bass amp.
I'm sorry, but where there's a will, there's a way.
Yeah, it was incredible.
And no excuse for anyone not to be able to play the drums.
So immediately I thought, well, this is cool, and we were playing in pubs, and I was allowed to stay out till 2 o'clock in the morning, and they introduced me to Black American music, which was a thing which was complete. You know, such a departure from the classical world that I was in. At this time, I was going to the Royal Academy of Music on Saturdays, but with this voice, I stuck out in the cafeteria, in that I was a bit, you know, from the wrong side of the tracks regarding the rest of the students. So when this opportunity to play soul music and American music came along, I grabbed it with both hands, and so I taught myself everything from that moment on. I taught myself to play by ear. I taught the art of funk. I taught myself the art of funk and soul and jazz and anything that grooved that made me and my mum dance. I grabbed hold of it, and I used to have little C90 tapes, little cassette tapes, and I would play these things that I loved, James Brown records, and I would rewind and rewind until I learnt how it worked. And then all of a sudden, I left the Royal Academy in a terrible argument with the whole system. I walked out halfway through the term.
Sounds quite rebellious.
I went through that rebellious, acne-ridden stage via this love for soul and funk music. And my mother washed her hands of me and said, you're on your own. And then all of a sudden, I answered, there was a newspaper called The Melody Maker where you used to get gigs. You'd look in the adverts every week. And there was a band called The Pasadenas who were big at the time. They were a five-piece, all-singing soul group. And they used to dance like crazy. And I auditioned for them and I got the gig. And the first gig was the Albert Hall. And so my mother went, oh, okay, I'll let you do this now. And I used to copy their dance moves. It's just a sort of a relentless display of expressing myself.
Was that part of the audition?
It wasn't. No.
just did it anyway.
And I don't think they approved, really, but they seemed to sort of think, well, just leave him alone. He's all right over there. And it was through them that I then found myself in a band that I already loved called the Brand New Heavies, which were part of the acid jazz movement. I was already wearing flared trousers and blue glasses and long hair. I looked the part. I loved their music. They took me on 2 world tours. And
casual.
And I met a wonderful lady called Saida Garrett, who wrote Man in the Mirror for Michael Jackson.
At what age is this?
When I'm 21 this? By okay. now. This amazing lady, Saida Garrett, she lived in LA. She wrote Man in the Mirror for Michael Jackson. She toured with Michael Jackson, and she became a sort of a mentor for me. She taught me how to not take any crap and how to stick up for yourself and believe in yourself, because she believed in me.
What was her advice?
Well, her advice was she was very sassy, you know, and her attitude went right down to the core. Like the occupation that she chose to keep herself busy within studios was knitting. So she would knit almost defiantly against the sort of the whole role model of what you'd expect from a studio environment. She would knit, and when she was making a point, she would knit more, vehemently. And she taught me to just not take it. Yeah, this thing of not taking any crap. She would fight her corner, and she taught me that I was quite good at this. You know, she gave me a level of confidence. But throughout all this, going back to the original theme of this chat, throughout all this, I was very much other people's keyboard player. I was other people's piano player, and I was from a, you know, we were in a, let's get the violins out, but we were from a little maisonette in Hayes, you know, and so I didn't feel I had that option to be artistic, and I didn't have the license to just go on an exploratory mission. I had to earn money first. So I was learning my trade and learning about music by being paid, by being in these bands, but I had a yearning to express myself with all that I'd learnt. And by this time I'd been schooled in funk, soul, all these things. And then I started to veer off into dance music because of the style of piano that I played lent itself very much to music that had a 4 on the floor under it. So I was getting calls from garage producers and house producers and all the guys at Flying Records, Charlie Chester's lot, Lofty, the label called Chili Funk. They got me involved, and we started a thing called East West Connection with Dr. Bob Jones. Again, soul-based house. And then in an effort to sort of, by this time I'd bought a house off the proceeds of the Brand New Heavies tour and then sold it to buy a load of studio equipment. So I was that committed to finding this voice that I sold all of my possessions and cashed it in for a load of musical
equipment. Was that a big decision? Because it sounds like now you're like, oh yeah, I did that, and then I just, yeah, got rid because I wanted to do this. Like, that's a big decision to make.
It is an enormous decision. I was 25 when I made that decision. I had my little flat in Twickenham. I'd worked hard to get it, but I wasn't happy. I wasn't happy paying a mortgage. I felt I just needed more space to find my voice. And I wanted to prove something to someone, whatever it was, whoever it was. I wanted to prove something. So I made that brave decision, and I moved back in a bedsit, bought all this equipment, So I'm now 25, and I'm kind of back to square one, but I've got loads of stuff to record things on. But I'm still searching. So I then immersed myself in various different scenes. One of the most extreme of those, in an effort to find my voice, was the psytrance scene. I was in a band called the Green Nuns of the Revolution, which was a three-piece psytrance act. I mean, I just landed in this. The way I got there, I played with. Do you remember Gabrielle with the eye patch?
Yes, yeah. Of course I do.
Yeah. Well, so that was another session gig of mine, and
still play all of her tunes.
Yeah, Walk On By and all that. Yeah, she's lovely. So I did that for a very short amount of time, and the reason I did it for a very short amount of time is I was kind of done with working for other people. But she was lovely, and there was a guitarist in that band called Matt Coldrick, and he was in this band, the Green Under the Revolution, and he said, come and help us out. So I then found myself in this really grotty little bedsit in Fulham, which I found out was Psytrance HQ the world over. Everything went through this flat, including a lot of drugs, a lot of people, and it was just endless going on the whole time.
24/7.
Yeah. So I met these incredible people, and
sounds like an episode of Peep Show.
It was. It was exactly like that. And I met this incredible group of people who went from one eclipse party to the next across the globe. This was a luxury. Again, I couldn't afford. These people were obviously well minted that they could afford to do this. So I didn't relate to them. But it was. You know, at one point I ended up on an ostrich farm in South Africa playing an illegal rave. 8 o'clock in the morning, watching ostriches run across the dance floor, thinking, what's happened to my life? I sold a house. I had everything. I sold a house in Twickenham. I was doing great on the session scene. People were ringing me, and I've sold it all out to watch this ostrich dance across the dance floor with going on behind me. But you know what? I was kind of happy.
I was going to say, throughout this, it kind of seems like you've made these decisions, and sometimes you make a big decision, like getting rid of your house. Was it always, like, were you always happy with it? Did you ever, like, think, what have I done here?
Yeah, that's a good question, because, I mean, that haunts you throughout your life. Right from the point where I had a place much earlier than that at the Leeds College of Music, which I didn't take. It was a jazz course. I couldn't really afford to go up there. I kind of was worried that I would end up being a generic musician like all the others that they churned out, or at least that's what I told myself. I regretted that, or rather it haunted me for about 10 years, thinking I should have. That's always there in every decision that you make. That's the thing about music. I mean, my personal trainer, which I've now got, was talking to me about this the other day. He was saying, I don't know whether to play electric or acoustic guitar, and I've done all my research, and I feel that acoustic would be the proper way to go, but electric is what my heart tells me. And I said, that's the essence of what being a creative is ignoring the logic and going with the heart and the passion.
Go with the electric.
Go with the electric. That's what I said to him, because that's what he wants to do. And that's always, you know, these decisions are quite often really, really dangerous. But the more dangerous, the kind of more attractive, and the better the result when you eventually get there, and the more hellish the journey in getting to that point. So that was certainly the case in my mid-20s at this era. We're talking about, there's a lot of dialogue in my brain.
Yeah. So it kind of feels as well, you've got this like background, you've got this talent, and you're managing to kind of mold yourself into all these different things, and then you're finding your feet, you're finding kind of your voice and what you want to do. Where did you then go from there? Because like you said, you were rethinking some of these decisions, but then you just kept going and you kept doing. What was the next thing? What was the next step that like got you?
Well, there's like, you know, in all walks of life, it's never a clear-cut story, and so it's always a little bit blurred. And so for the next in my late 20s, I turned the phone off to doing session work, but occasionally a bit crept through because I needed some money, or I liked the people doing it, mainly because I liked the people doing it. I only ever really have worked with people I like working with. If I don't like working with people, I tend not to do it. You know, that's the opposite of what this should be about, really.
Who's your favourite person that you've worked with?
In terms of loveliness, Well, Saida would be one of them. She's in my psyche. Mainly speaking, everyone tends to be lovely. There are only a few. I mean, if you want to mention the people that we don't like,
he's the biggest person that you played with.
No. But yeah, I mean,
he's going to drop a clanger soon. I just know.
Oh, it'll come. It'll come with this.
I'll catch it. Don't worry.
Yeah, verbal diarrhea. I will. Yeah. But yeah, so I did some work with 07. For a year or so, on and off. And that actually solidified an idea in my mind that about what my voice was. A combination of two things. Firstly, that, I can sing, but I've always chosen not to. You know, I could sing. I could have done. Firstly, I don't trust my voice. Secondly, I feel that this I can express myself a lot more through a keyboard. The other thing, the decision I came to with 07 is they had about six singers, and I came to a fairly broad decision, present company excluded, that singers drive me nuts. Quite often, singers do my head in, you know, in terms of the game you have to play in terms of getting to the point. Also, to be fair to singers, I think I'm quite difficult because I've got quite a bold voice instrumentally. So it made me decide that being an instrumental artist was the most important thing to me.
Yeah. Do we have any singers in the audience?
Sorry. Oh, everyone. Oh, good.
Do you have any pianists? Yeah, a couple. Yeah, nice. Okay.
I mean, I'm being flippant about the singers. I mean, it's just a sense that we were about to go on a bus around America with six singers, and there were so many arguments going on between them, it drove me nuts. Six on the same bus. Yeah. So I decided that I would start this act called Fragile State, which was very much a down tempo thing, and it was using all the soulful elements that I'd previously been exposed to, and kind of nice drum beats. And I got this DJ guy involved to sort of help me kind of cross that bridge into what was happening at that time. Because you kind of always need that someone to keep you on board with what's kind of around and what's going on. I find it's good to do that.
Who was it?
A guy called Ben Minot. He was a DJ at Blues and Soul at the time. And I met him through a mutual friend. And I had a little flat in Putney by this point, and I was desperate to put out that record that I did from start to finish, where I wasn't sort of looking at ostriches where it was just like it was purely from the soul. And we did that record in about 6 weeks, that first record in about 6 weeks, and we got in the right state of mind to do it in terms of extracurricular. And it was very much, we buried ourselves in that room for about 6 weeks, and then we came out and we had this album, and I tentatively gave it to Ben to give to a record company that he knew, and they sort of went, yeah, we love it, and they stuck it out.
Is we, you and the DJ that you were working with, yeah. And then when did the trio come about? Is that
well,
next?
Well, that ties on from that, because Fragile State put out two albums, and just at the point when they were going to pay us our royalties, because we sold quite a lot of records, actually, they went bust, and so I was left with nothing, and I thought, well, when you've got nothing, the obvious thing to do is to start a jazz trio.
Yep, yes.
There's no other place to go, really.
That's sometimes what I think, yeah.
Yeah, and so my dad had a jazz trio, and I thought, that sounds romantic. So I got rid of that down-tempo, because the Fragile State was sort of down-tempo chill stuff. It's a horrible phrase, but it was chill stuff. And
I love chilled music.
Well, no, it's fine to love it. It's just the phrase itself.
Okay.
I did this jazz trio thing. I'd never done any proper jazz gigs of any note. I hadn't done my graft as they would expect me to do. I hadn't played all the clubs. I'd played a lot of jazz. I'd done it for pleasure, but I hadn't gone around the circuit for 10 years and done my graft.
Why was that a thing for you? Why did that matter?
Well, it didn't matter to me, but it mattered to the... I suddenly released a record that was classed as jazz. I kind of didn't know whether it was jazz, but I was told it was jazz. I mean, it's ridiculous to say that now. It had an acoustic bass, drums and piano. it kind of looked like a jazz trio. It kind of was a jazz trio, but it was trying to incorporate other elements. So it sounded a little bit more aggressive, a little bit more forceful. I tried to channel all these other bits of music, all the psytrance stuff, into this jazz format. But I was more worried about what the people in jazz thought, having, you know... I mean, I loved Errol Garner, I loved Ahmad Jamal, I loved all these old American jazz artists, but I hadn't, you know, gone to college and done it to the nth degree. And I think possibly a few people went, the bloody cheek of the guy, you know.
There's a lot of history in jazz as well.
Not history, yeah, which I don't think anyone should be, you know, alienated from. It's just that we by some freak accident, we won a BBC Jazz Award for that first album. So I turned up at the award ceremony and... Julian Joseph, who's a lovely guy, but he did say as he announced the award, right, I've never heard of these guys, but it's Neil Cowley Trio, and on we wandered. And so I went, well, thanks. Okay, yep, we're jazz, apparently, and thanks ever so much.
I can't imagine introing someone like that.
No, he just...
And I've never heard of these guys before.
That's what he said. It's kind of
honest.
A compliment. Yeah, it was honest, yeah. And so we found ourselves doing this then the next 10 years, effectively, turning the Neil Cowley Trio into something that felt as if I was expressing a voice beyond a genre in the hope that it was expressing something wider. And we incorporated as many other elements into it as possible, but always... You know, I was a stupid idiot. I put trio in the title, so, you know, it was going to be associated with jazz, but always... trying to incorporate these other elements, and we played later with Jules, which was a big moment for us, and we toured around for about 10 years. It was fantastic, a really fantastic experience with two people who I adore, I love like brothers, Rex and Evan. And then it came to 2016, and we put out an album called Spacebound Apes, and we did an incredible book. And all sorts of multimedia stuff associated with it, videos and things like that. And yet it felt like it was time for a change. And it felt like, in all honesty, it felt like the Neil Cowley Trio had done that, and it had sort of done that, and it was kind of doing that. And the next question for me was, is it about to do that? Or is there any way I can make it do that? And I thought, actually, that's too much. That's too much of an agenda. I think I want to just wipe the slate clean and reinvent myself. The last 3 years, which we can get into, has been an extremely interesting, sometimes painful, but ultimately rewarding exercise in reinvention and why it's important, the pitfalls of it, and why it's important to do it, essentially.
It's such an interesting process to hear about. As someone, I interview a lot of artists who are starting out in their career. I present the BBC Music Introducing in London show. And every single week, we've got a new artist, someone that we think we're going to support like through their career and their journey. And it's really interesting to hear from a perspective where you actually weren't tied to this idea that you're this you're now this brand and you will never leave that and you're going to push that until the end. You are the talent and you're navigating your way through. So, yeah, like through reinventing, instead of thinking, oh, I need to ditch this and then go into this. It's kind of like you've got projects and you're still proud of them. They still were them, but you're kind of almost really consciously thinking that actually, yeah, this is where that project's at, and now I'm going to move on to this. But you haven't ever like lost sight of what you want to do and what it is.
Yeah.
What were the hardest parts about kind of departing one sort of act and then moving on to
well,
the next?
Just the mere nature of unpicking something that is, you know, by some measures successful. Just doing that and depriving yourself of a successful engine which you can tap into. I mean, I love playing live more than anything else, really, that I do. It gives me more pleasure to play live in front of people than anything. And I love to travel with it. It gives me an incredible passport to go and see so many wonderful places. To deprive myself of that, potentially, and also for that to potentially never come back, because you never know, is one of the most frightening things to do. It's very easy to go, okay, I'm going to coast now and know that I can just keep picking away at this trio element, and I could keep playing live and it will be okay. But it didn't match my ambition to sort of keep expressing and widening my remit. So that's the first thing, is unpicking something that's fairly successful. Waving goodbye to a group of people that you love working with or that you associate with, that's difficult. You lose a family in so many ways. The most scary one, I suppose, is hiding behind, a wall as you present something new to people that you're fans, being petrified of what's going to happen. I mean, we talked about trolling the other day very, very, very briefly, and I was recounting when we first went on late, we went on Later with Jules, and MySpace was a thing then. MySpace was the way that you communicate with people. And I remember when we played Later with Jules, we recorded it the night before, so I was able to watch the show and watch MySpace and watch the followers go up. Yeah. And it was very, very obvious. As we played, all these followers came in, thousands. And I was really, really...
That must have been a really good feeling, though.
Incredible feeling. Like, wow, this has really, really worked. I eventually got the video, I put it on YouTube. A lot of us were very new to social media, but I put it on YouTube and I put, the comments came in, what a great band. And I was wearing a scarf, right? What a great band. What an energy. What a bass player. Scarf shit. It butchered me, and I thought, wow, I'm really open to the elements here, And I used to talk about it at gigs, which is a really stupid thing to do, because then whenever I put anything up on social media, loads of people would put scarf shit underneath it. Didn't matter what it was.
Even when you weren't wearing a scarf.
Even I wasn't wearing scarves. So there's always that thing with the trolling element and the worry about what people are going, how they're going to react. And we've put out stuff recently, and it's been gloriously wonderful how people have supported my new stuff. But there's always one who just goes, don't get it, And you're always that's the fear, because you're a sensitive artist. You're about to do something, and it makes me really admire the courage of people who regimentally reinvented themselves, such as a David Bowie. Or any of these people. And it's also very interesting when I see people who don't reinvent themselves because it's too scary to do so. And I think the long-term game is a bit of a cul-de-sac if you do that. However horrifying it is to start again, however horrifying it is to put yourself open to people's criticism once again and to essentially start from the bottom, it must be done. And when you do it, and when it suddenly finally starts to come together, it's the most incredibly liberating feeling, a feeling of, I was right after all. And I think, I've literally ventured into that area in very recent times with this, but just that sense that, I really do understand what is happening with this now,
Well, people hate change though, don't they? So as long as you stick with it, then afterwards, as long as you've got the confidence to stick with it, I guess people, your fans, the ones who are actual fans, will, I guess, trust you. Yeah. So I do actually get people, and usually it is like artists who've kind of been there and done that, and they're like, oh, but I don't want to go through that process of like trying again, like starting from scratch. What advice would you give to them? Do you think they need to fully rebrand? Do you think they can rebrand in a like reinvent in a different way?
Well, I was thinking really in terms of... I was thinking of a really amazingly huge example of someone who didn't rebrand and reinvent, and it's someone associated with myself, because as we've discussed, I played on Adele's first two albums, So I played on her first two albums, and I played on 19, and that did amazingly well, and then I played on 21, and that did ridiculously well. And then we sort of parted company, and I didn't do anything on 25. And I was thinking at home, what's she going to do? Because the opportunity for her now is so incredible. She could do whatever she likes. And I wondered about all the elements that would be pressurizing her. I wondered about the or what ambitions she had. And I think a prime ambition in her case would, I know she loves huge success. I know she loves that. She takes it as a real incentive, and she's very admirable in that. She's got a hell of a drive. And I also knew that the people around her would, obviously, she's got so many, she's responsible for so many people because she makes so much money. But I did wonder whether she might be given the carte blanche to do something that was purely about her roots, like a real Etta James type record or something really soulful. And then when I heard 25, I thought, wow, she hasn't reinvented herself at all. There isn't no reinvention. Now, that sold an unbelievable amount of records. But I wonder whether that was a wise move. And this is not me saying it wasn't, but I wonder in the long term whether someone of her magnitude needs to reinvent. I think it's an exercise. It's not a critique of her, but it's an exercise in whether she should, whether she could, and what would happen if she did. I think it would be amazing if she suddenly brought out an album that was purely from her soul.
You know. Like a dance album or something.
Something like that. You know, just
or
something
like a reggae version of Adele.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
I mean, I'd buy it. Well, I'd buy it, yeah.
Well, she's got a hell of a voice. That's the thing, you know.
Yeah, that is really interesting. I actually do want to know, though, like, how was the initial meet with, how did you get to work with Adele in the first place? Were you at a point where you were session playing, or...?
I turned my back on session playing for about 5 or 6 years. I was doing the trio. It was about 2007, and I got a call from an old friend who was managing a producer called Jim Abbas. And she said, we're going in the studio with this girl on Monday. It's her first day in the studio. And she's called Adele, and she's got her own band from Brit School, but the keyboard player's decided he wants to keep his job at Sainsbury's because he doesn't think the band's going anywhere. Do you want to do it? So I said, all right then. I mean, I didn't know who she was. So I went, yeah, okay, all right. So I went in, and it was, like I said, it was a Monday morning, and we did a tune called Hometown Glory, and we did it in pretty much one take. She set up on one side of the room, and I set up on the other side of the room, and it was very much a duet in its core. And she was a real one-take wonder, which I appreciated because I've got zero patience. So it suited me down at the ground. And then from that moment on, we always recorded, pretty much always recorded the records like that. So it was always her and me in the room, and then they would add stuff afterwards. But, you know, the collective amount of time I spent in that studio with her would probably amount to about, 18 hours, and then I spent the next 8 years listening to it in every single restaurant I went into. But it was, and it was that arpeggiated piano thing, all that stuff. I can't play it with one hand, but everything then, without being conceited, it did set up this environment where everything became an arpeggiated piano in the world. This is Hometown Glory is this one. And I thought, when I got the record, I thought, oh, yeah, that's a nice little sort of ostinato thing. And then I don't watch, the Britain's Got Talent of this world or the voice of the... I don't tend to, but my wife does, and I used to walk past the living room every Saturday, and I'd walk past, and I'd hear this. And I'd walk past, hang on a minute, what's happening? And it'll always be some poor soul saying, you've not made judges' houses. It was always some sob story or some guy's got some death in the family.
Makes me cry every time. Yeah.
And so the arpeggiated piano thing, I thought, wow, I'm associated with everyone's woe. But it became a thing, so much so that A&R men from record companies would parade me around the office. There was one guy who called me up to his office. I had no understanding why he'd called me in, other than to say, that's the... And that was my thing. And so that lasted for a while. And then I did Rolling in the Deep, and then the world of piano parts became a little bit more positive. It became this. Well, that's actually Emily Sandy next to me, because I did I can't even play Rolling in the Deep now, but it's essentially a pounding octave thing. It's that. So, you know, simple piano motif number four then became huge across the globe. And then I got called to go and do that. So Emily Sandy rang me up and said, will you play next to me?
Another clang.
So all this education that we've talked about, classical music education, all this beautiful music that I've listened to, and I end up playing sad ostinatos of people who have left Britain's Got Talent and pounding octaves.
I bet your mum was really proud, though.
My mum? Yeah, she would have been. She would have been. My mum was proud of everything, of course, because I was still a little boy. But yes, it was. So that was the Adele thing, really, and then, like I say, the curse that I've inflicted upon the world is the arpeggiated piano, and I do take credit for that in some form. I'm proud of it, and yet cursed by it in a sense. I listen to it and I go, yeah, that's in some way part of those hugely successful records, because she's very good, and when she originally did that. The Brit Awards performance and all the stuff sparkled down with it. It was one take, and I just knew, well, she's not going to have any problems because she does it every time, The irony about Adele is I think that really her life ambition is to actually be an A&R person. I think that she really wants to just sign other bands. I think that's her real passion.
I'm sure she can do that.
She could do that.
She's Adele.
She's Adele, and I'm sure she will. I think that she loves selling records in any form. And I don't think she really minds whether she sings or not. I really don't think she does. I mean that genuinely. I don't think she really worries about her voice too much. So that was my association with her. And as I say, three afternoons in total, and I spent the next 10 years listening to it. But as I sit here in front of you today, the thing I'm passionate about, the thing that I care about, the thing that I want to tell everyone about, is my stuff, but that's because every waking moment is spent caring about that, because I feel there's something I need to say, and it's irrelevant, whether I play bloody octaves on Britain's Got Talent.
And I feel like maybe you've, you have kind of answered, but what makes you walk away from someone as successful as Adele? Is it literally your passion? You wanted
totally
to do other stuff?
Totally.
It's like... You've
it's
done
my
that.
Stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, really, it's as selfish as that. No, I was asked by Jonathan, a manager, to go and...
It just seems like such a big decision. Like, to an outside perspective, it kind of seems like you've got this, like, mad successful thing. Mm-hmm. And I know you said for the next 10 years it haunted you, but at the time it had not been 10 years. So, was that hard?
No,
was it hard?
That's a really interesting question, because I was offered to go and play with her live, and I had absolutely no passion to do it whatsoever. And because I care so much about this journey, and believe it or not, sitting in here talking to you today is a little step in that journey. And I get to do this because I'd rather talk to one person. I'd rather relate to one person in the right way, for the rest of my life, than millions in the wrong way. It really matters that much to me. Ironically, when Jonathan asked me to play with Adele live, because I'd done the recordings, he said, we're going on Later with Jules next week. He said, would you come and play with her? And I went...
Wear a scarf.
And I said, no, I'm going to hold out, Jonathan, because I'm really passionate that my band does it. Yeah. And he went, really? And I went, yeah, I am. And he went, well, he said, all I'm saying is if you come on to Later with Jules with Adele, maybe they'll have your band on. I said, Jonathan, they're not going to look at the keyboard player at the back in the shadows and go, I wonder if he's got a band. They're not going to invite me on that token. They're obviously, if I retain my integrity.
Unless all the comments are about you and your scarf.
And my scarf, yeah. So I said, there's not, that's ridiculous, Jonathan. No, I'll refrain. Strangely, and there was providence, 2 days later, a band flying in from New York cancelled being on Later with Jules, and I got the call to be on the same show. So the show I'm on is with her on it. So I turned up at the Jules Holland studios the following Tuesday.
Oh, was that not the most satisfying thing?
It was like when you see someone does this to you and then they crash into a lamppost. So and I saw his face as I walked in, and he went, what the f-? I said, all right, Jonathan. He said, you're winding me up. And I said, no, my band's on. Oh, you tapped me up, didn't you? You tapped me right up. I said, no, I'm serious. It's actually happening. So I just, my pure motivation, if you watch that video of me, I'm actually watching his face in the sidelines like that, smiling at him like that. So that was pleasurable. And that proves my point.
Yes.
You've got to stick to what you love.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. Okay, so, yeah, tell me more about what you're doing now. I know you had recently a performance at the Pickle Factory. I've seen so many videos of that, and it looks incredible. It looked like one of the best nights ever. I know a couple of people who were there, and they were just like, yeah, it was insane.
It was wonderful, yeah.
Pickle Factory is a great venue as well.
It's a beautiful venue, great sound. That actually is an example of another happenstance which benefited me, because... I've always wanted to work with incredible drummers. That's always my thing. They inspire me. So I've been working with one drummer who's lovely and amazing. But he decided he was going to get married in LA the day of the Pickle Factory gig. And I'd booked him first. And I told him that. So I was in a panic. And I rang a guy called Andy Gangadine, who's Chase and Status's drummer. I've known Andy for a long time.
Casual,
cat clang. He said he'd help me out, and it was a beautiful coming together. He's like a human drum machine, Andy, and it's kind of what we've been trying to aspire towards with my music, is to try... I've gone electronic, basically, you know, hugely electronic, and I'm enjoying that journey, but I wanted the drummer that could help me fulfill that ambition live, and I fell on my feet with Andy, so I'm hopeful that that will continue. I've always played with energy. I've always enjoyed playing with energy when in a band situation. And when I'm not in a band situation, I tend to play very quietly and very sedately and very serenely and try and make people cry. So I like there to be a large gamut of emotions. But that was a good gig. Yeah.
And what was it like going from doing piano, I guess, in this jazz world to then transforming, reinventing to the dance world? I mean, you always had kind of a DJ on board in Fragile State, and then now you've kind of, I guess you've brought everything that you liked together and you've now made your thing. Do you sometimes think, I should have done this earlier? Or do you actually think, because you're now saying this is you and this is your thing, do you think you'll get bored of this and then you'll move on to another thing as well?
Well, I think it's healthy to do that. I mean, we're talking years, but I mean, it's healthy to do that. It's an interesting what you say about should I have done it earlier. Actually, honestly, I think I should have made some changes, maybe an album sooner in my journey. I don't regret. I never regret what I've put out, because I'm very proud of what I put out. But I think in the background scenes, I could have made a few changes earlier and been bolder with it. And I think the thing that I tend to kick myself about most is not doing something early enough. That really eats away at me. If I feel like I've missed the boat because I've not made a cutthroat decision, and I'm quite nice, actually, you know, which is another real bad move in the music industry. And like, if I'm working with people and I'm thinking, I could do with a change, but I haven't got the heart to say, really, you know, that can happen. But, you know, there's a very good point about doing it early enough. I think you've got to be really harsh with it and really cutthroat. And the decision has got to be entirely fueled by the art. You know, what does the art demand? And if the art is going to be slightly staged or slightly stayed, or, you know, it's going to fester for an album, you can't really afford to make that mistake. You've got to really keep surging forward. And the other thing which comes into it, if I'm really candid, is age. You know, age is a really important part. And you have this quandary about, do I reinvent myself and get down with the youth? Or do I stick on this path because I'm now a mature musician and I know all my music theory and I know what I want to say, and it's got to be grandiose and very, very highfalutin. And I think I kind of dance around from one extreme to the other. Sometimes I make music which I think is extremely complex and extremely highbrow. And then other times I just want to thrash around and play with energy. So I can't even work myself out, really. Maybe these people can. Let's have a vote.
A lot of what you've done, so it kind of, it all seems like, to me, I don't know whether it's just because we're talking about it in hindsight, but every decision that you've kind of made has been like super conscious, and you've made these changes for yourself, which obviously is great. How did you manage the people around you in terms of like management, like say with going from this group to then transforming to this next thing. Obviously for you, that was your transformation, you were doing that. How did you manage like the people around you?
Well, I changed virtually everyone around me, really. And that's...
That must have been quite hard.
It's horrific. Horrific, yeah. I mean, the manager I was with for 10 years, who's a friend, who I spoke to daily, on a daily basis, I had to say to her, I'm going to try something new. And that's never easy. How do you say that without making someone feel like it's their fault? And I don't think it's possible to succeed at that, really. Yeah, that's extremely difficult. And then obviously my band members, who I love like brothers, and I miss terribly, and I love playing with. That's even harder in a way. Yeah, pretty much everything changed around me. But I used it, once I'm sort of through a certain patch of that, I use the new people around me to inspire me to think in new ways. I mean, the management I'm with now, are an electronic, you know, predominantly in electronic music. They understand that genre of, you know, richly. They're hugely successful acts on their roster. And I, you know, secretly, I kind of used what they have to offer to drive me on to discover certain things.
Did you approach them or did they approach you?
I did a trio gig, pretty much my last trio gig in a basement of my publisher's. Gary came along and rang me the next day and spoke to me for 2 hours. And I was seeing a selection of managers. My lawyer had set me up with a selection of managers, and I met them, and I was sort of making my decision. And then Gary came along and talked to me for 2 hours. And by the end of it, he'd sort of sorted out my life for me. And I didn't know quite what had happened, but I was suddenly signing to him. I went away and went, I've got to sign to this guy. He's amazing. I feel great, you know. I feel young. I feel slim. I feel... and I thought, yeah, this guy can dig me out of any hole. And he had a vision. He had a very clear vision for me. I mean, since then he spent his time saying to me, well, this isn't what I envisaged at all, you know, what you've come out with. But he was very clear, and it drove me on. Anyone who's got that clarity of vision, I thought, well, they know what they want from this. I'm going to go with it. That's a good energy, and that will dig me out of this hole because I'm laying myself to the wolves here.
It almost seems like the kind of route you've taken, it means that you've got the kind of contacts and relationships around you to, I guess, have the luxury to change. Do you feel like that, or has it been harder than?
Yeah, I suppose seems? There's a certain sense of I've been doing this long enough. I should be okay. I think I've made enough of a mark that I can just about get into a new chapter. You know, and I think on a very close, deep personal level, you're thinking, well, look, if this all goes wrong, what's the worst that can happen? Or what's the worst that would happen? And as long as I'm playing music, I'll be okay. So I always think that at the back of my mind. If push comes to shove, I'll just go out and play. I don't know who to or what, but I will. At least that's there, because I know that won't leave me. So that's your sort of safety net. We must be really
rocked on. Yeah, I know. I was just going to check on time because I actually really want you to play something of your own.
I was just thinking, what shall I play?
Also, if anyone has any questions.
Oh, yeah, got any questions?
Yeah, after stick that tirade. I don't know. I feel like I've just literally just been chatting away.
How do you recognize the need for change and like to evolve in something else from the actual fear to just actually commit and dig deeper into something, because that's my problem.
Right, okay. Well, yeah, that's a good question. So what you're saying is, you know, you've got this decision. Do I dig deeper in the thing that I'm doing now, or do I completely change everything that I'm doing? Well, if I'm really honest, I think that I spent 10 years digging so deep into something, into a certain area. I was extremely committed to that, but then I think it was, I just wanted to change the language that I use and take myself completely out of any comfort zone and see what happened. I just felt like I wanted to just, yeah, really stand on the cliff edge. If you're struggling to know whether you need to go deeper. It depends how many times you've gone deeper in this particular project that you're doing, really.
I always like to go as deep as possible. But I think if you always think about that graph, if you feel like it's about to do that, jump, get out of there quick. It's time to do that. It really is. It's time to cut it. Yeah, I think.
What happens if you're talking about like kind of the success of it with your graph, right?
Oh, yeah.
What about if the passion, if you really feel like that's your thing and it's just...
What, the current path you're on is your passion?
Yeah, like if you're doing it and you're just like, but I really enjoy it, but it's just not really happening.
Well, that's the thing. I think it's down to the individual. If your passion is to keep doing it, even if there's just one person left looking at you doing it, then you're on the right path. I mean, absolutely. I think I have an inherent idea that there's something better going on elsewhere. And that's a personal weakness of mine. It's like, oh, okay, someone's having a better time than me, so I better go looking for it. That's my fault, and that's what drives me on to do
that's
this.
That's called FOMO, if you want to
ask. Is that what it's called?
Fear of missing out, yeah.
FOMO?
Yeah.
I learned something new here today at Tobacco Doc.
Have we got any other questions? Oh, I've got someone at the back. Just getting my steps in, guys. Oh, there, look. Oh, we've got someone with another microphone.
Hello.
Hello.
So... It seems like you choose a new genre when you reinvent yourself. And right. I wondered if there's like a foundation that you have whenever you choose a new genre to rebuild a sound. Like, how do you decide what you're going to do first?
In terms of, whether if I'm going to go for a particular genre, you mean?
Yeah.
It's a good question in the sense that I can't remember. It feels like it's totally organic. I mean, I do know that In my quest for understanding the language of this particular genre I find myself in, I've bought an inordinate amount of electronic equipment. I have submerged myself in so many manuals of synths and drum machines and everything else, and actually it's been detrimental at times. I keep buying gear in the hope that that's going to be the answer. Yeah. So I keep buying a new piece of equipment, and all I'm doing is giving myself more manuals to read, and that old adage of each piece of equipment is another step between you and a good idea. I'm building on that and building on that and building on that. I mean, when it comes in terms of deciding a genre is for me, I think, can I hear my voice in it? You know, do I have a valid voice? I mean, I think it's obvious to say that I couldn't ever imagine myself being involved in any kind of metal offshoot. You know, there wouldn't be a voice for me in that. I mean, the whole trio thing was born out of bands like The Bad Plus and EST, and my band was always sort of bracketed in that way. And I have to say, in all honesty, I saw EST in 2002, and I was amazed at what they could do with... ostensibly piano, bass and drums, but other things and other palettes and other noises. And I thought, yeah, that feels like I can relate to that. I can have a voice in there. So it's about whether you can hear your voice in it, or if you're irritated by the way that other people do it, even, you know. I think hearing your voice within it, that's the sort of first moment, I think.
Thanks.
We've got 5 minutes left, okay. So... Are you able to play something?
I'll play Grace, because that's the first thing that springs to mind. But it's quite quiet, and we'll all sit here going, it's too quiet for this room, but I'll play it anyway. Is there someone gesticulating at me in the door? She's either giving me really rude hand signals or telling me to get off. I'm not quite sure. Anyway, okay, here we go.
People trying to break in.
Thanks. Thank you.
What's that one called again?
Grace.
Grace.
Thanks, Jess.
Thank you very much, Neil Cowley. Thank you very much, everyone who's here. I hope you enjoy the rest of your experience at Introducing Live. Thank you.
Thanks, Jess. Thanks for having me.